us to stand, God, that we would take the blood of Jesus Christ and apply it afresh to our heart, Lord, and cleanse us from secret sins and things that are going on in our life. I'm praying this morning, God, that you would please work and move through the congregation, that the Holy Spirit of God would have his way in every person's heart and in every person's life. Lord, if there's someone here that has yet to take Jesus Christ as their Savior, I'm asking you that the blood would be applied today. Lord, if there is a Christian in here that hasn't confessed his sins and hasn't earnestly contended for the faith, I'm praying this morning that the blood would be applied. Lord, that they could come on and serve God acceptably and do what's right. And thank God for a fountain filled with blood, Lord, where we can go. Thank God for a place where we can be cleansed and we can go underneath the fountain, Lord, and be washed and cleansed from our sins. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Amen. All right, verses 18 and 19 of 1 Peter say that for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, nothing as stupid and filthy and ungodly as that. I mean, you know, everybody trying to get for gold, but from your vain conversation received by tradition from your father, but you were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. And I thank God for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. I want to say that that the theme of the Bible, all the way from Genesis, when Cain and Abel were around, and when Adam and Eve first sinned against God, and the Lord God had to take that knife and slit that lamb's throat and make them some coats of skins for them to wear, the theme of the Bible from Genesis all the way to the book of Revelation there is a scarlet line that runs all the way through there, stained crimson red by the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm happy about that blood. You cut out the blood out of the new song books, you cut out the blood out of the new Bibles, and you know what you've got? You've got a powerless, worthless religion that won't save from sin, that won't edify, that won't build up anybody. It has nothing to offer anybody. You might as well take those new Bibles and take the new song books and carry them over to the edge of the Grand Canyon and pull the lever on the dump truck that you've thrown them into and just let them all fall down in there, and then have every dog that you know run around there and pour their dead bodies right on top of them, because that's just what they're worth. Absolutely nothing. You hear me? They took the blood of Jesus Christ out and it's worth nothing. The blood of Jesus Christ is what cleansed you from your sin. The theme of every Christian ought to be the blood of Jesus Christ. You ought not to witness to anybody on your job or in your neighborhood without mentioning the blood of Jesus Christ. It's the thing that cleansed you from your sin. You weren't cleansed from your sin because you went to church. You weren't cleansed from your sin because you did good works or took the sacraments or anything else. I'm telling you that it was nothing else but the blood of Jesus Christ that washed you and cleansed you from your sins. I thank God for it. You remove the blood from the body. Everybody in here, you take a stand up and just cut your wrist and let the blood drain out of your body. I'll tell you what you got a corpse. And you take a church and you remove the blood from the singing and the Bibles, and you got nothing but a dead corpse and a bunch of people sitting in that church that don't love God and got no plan of salvation. There's nothing that they can do. You take the blood out of Calvary from Christianity, you got a lifeless creed instead of a living faith that will save sinners and give them something to hope for. Listen, Fanny Crosby knew what she was talking about when she wrote down that song, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. William Cowper understood it when he said, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. Listen, this old song book that we've got has got just filled. You cut it anywhere, man, and it'll bleed. You take this Bible that we've got, you cut this thing anywhere. Cut it up and chop it up and get it away from you, because it's going to bleed. It's got the blood of Jesus Christ all through there, and thank God for it. Only eternity is ever going to reveal how precious and how powerful the blood really is. While sitting right over here about three rows back in here on a Friday night, and we were sitting up there, we were singing, saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and a new world begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one. And there was a little boy that was sitting there next to the woman that had just had a stroke,
And he sat over there and said, I need to get saved by the blood of the crucified one. And nobody knew anything about it. And that boy bowed his head and he called on Jesus Christ. Right there with the singing going on. And he said, God, I ain't got time to wait for the invitation. I want to get saved right now. Hallelujah. And he got saved. Thank God, I'm so glad that it's not depending on my ability or on something that you do, but the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from all sin. My God, Lord, I'm thankful for the excitement that I feel in this place this morning. Thank you, Father. Lewis E. Jones wrote a song. He said, there's power in the blood, and there is. There's power to save you from your ungodly, wicked life. There's power once you're saved to live for God and to do the right thing. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood of Jesus. Well, I want to say, first of all, that the blood of Jesus Christ is the price of our redemption. If the blood had not been shed on Calvary, you and I would still be lost in our sins. There'd be no hope for us. The blood is the price of our redemption. There are all kind of ways that this world has got of trying to get around and get away from the blood of Jesus Christ. The Christian scientists get over there and they just simply deny its existence. They say, well, if you think that there's blood, that's a Christian scientist, then there's blood. But really, there's no blood. But if you want to think that there is, you can just go ahead and think it. They deny its existence. The world says, well, we'll just pretend that it doesn't exist. The world says, I don't care if Jesus Christ died on the cross. I don't care if he shed all his blood on Calvary. What we're going to do is we're just going to sit here and pretend that he never did that, that he didn't die for anybody's sins, and we're going to ignore God. Now, see, they try to Catholics try to work it out. Catholics try to say, we got to get, not Jesus Christ. He's something else. But man, you got to light these candles for them people in purgatory. I mean, man, you got to come over here and pray for the dead. You got to pay the priests to say the masses to get the people out of hell. You got to do all of these kind of things. The Catholic is trying to work it out. But God has one way of putting it. Turn over to Hebrews. And your Bible, turn over to Hebrews. I want you to see this. Hebrews in chapter 9. Hebrews in chapter 9, God has only got one way of putting away sin. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
I said that God has only got one way of putting away sin. He ain't got a whole bunch of different ways of you getting saved. God has only got one way of getting saved. And that's found in Hebrews in chapter 9 and verse 25. Where the Bible said, nor yet that he... Let's back up. I want to go to verse 24. Verse 24 said, for Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. For us. Not for himself. He don't need to atone for his own sins. He didn't have any. He went to atone for me and for you. In verse 25, he said, nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entereth into the holy place every year with blood of others. For then must he have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, and I want you to notice, man, look at this thing. But now, once, only one time, once in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sin. How? By the sacrifice of himself. Brethren, when he hung on that cross, he shed his blood. And that blood will cover you from your sins. And I don't care what else you're trusting in. There's nothing else that will wash sin away but the blood of Jesus Christ. Nothing but the blood. There are some proposed ways of getting rid of your sin. What does man say about the blood? What is the modern interpretation today? Well, modernism says that it's a slaughterhouse religion. They'll tell you, get down over there at the Methodist church or some of these churches that don't like to preach about the blood. And man, they'll tell you that's just that old slaughterhouse religion. You got to have the blood applied. Man, you don't need the blood. Listen, I'm as good as anybody else. You don't have to have the blood of Jesus Christ applied. But that Bible said without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. I don't care what a man might say about it. A Jehovah Witness said that his blood only redeemed himself. Stupid idiots. You sit over there and study the Bible and study it and study it and study it and study it! And when it's all done and when it's all said, you're as stupid as you were when you went into the Bible study. You waste your time. You killed Jesus Christ afresh and anew every day. His blood just cleansed himself, my foot. And I'm telling you something, if every one of them people down at the Kingdom Hall would bow the knees of their heart and call on Jesus Christ even after blaspheming that holy name, that he'd save them. He'd wash them in that blood that they said they don't even believe in. He'd give them a fresh life. He'd give them something new to believe in. What men say about the blood. John MacArthur, one of your favorite radio preachers, some of you. John MacArthur said that the blood means nothing. It means nothing at all. It's the dead corpse, John MacArthur said, of the Lord Jesus Christ hanging on that cross that paid the pardon of your sin. Paid the price for your sin. What, John? He said that it was the corpse of the Lord Jesus Christ hanging on up there that pays the pardon for your sin. But you're going to have to excuse me because I have a Bible. And I go back in my Bible to the book of Exodus, right around Exodus chapter 12 or Exodus chapter 13. And I find that God telling them people to take a lamb and to spill his blood and to catch it in a basin and to apply. You're not supposed to take the dead corpse of the lamb and lay it across the lintel of the door. You're supposed to take the blood and apply it to the doorpost and the lintel of the door, and the firstborn would not die that night. That's right. So, I mean, he can go ahead and hang all the dead corpses. He can go ahead and fill that house up with dead corpses of lambs. It ain't going to make any difference. But what does the Bible say about the blood? What does the Bible have to say about blood? The Bible said that it's the life of man. Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, the Bible said, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood." That's what it says. "Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed." You can't live without blood. You just can't. I mean, you might think you can. The shedding of blood speaks of laying your life down. Man, you lose your blood, your life is over, brother. Now, I know they can pump it out. They got all kind of nifty things they can do. They pump it all out of you, pump new blood in, you know, all that kind of stuff. They can do all that. But I want you to notice with me, too, that the shed blood is all through the Old Testament. You get over there in the Old Testament, and blood is shed all throughout the Old Testament. And you don't really understand the New Testament. Listen, you can't fully comprehend what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary until you get back into that Old Testament and see how God dealt with them people back there with the blood. You just can't. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 21, Adam and Eve had sinned. They had ate of the fruit out of the garden. And God came to him looking for him in the cool of the evening and calling to him. And he said, "Where are you?" Adam says, "Man, we were afraid and because we were naked and we hid ourselves." And God said, "How'd you know you were naked? How'd you know that? Did you eat of the fruit?" I mean, God knew. He didn't have to ask him. Yeah. "Did you eat of the fruit of the, you know, confess, you know, get it up. Just like you need to do today." And you get back in that Old Testament and there that thing is. And God kills that lamb, a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. And covers the nakedness of Adam and Eve. Covers them up so that God can't see their nakedness, so that they're not ashamed to be around each other because of their nakedness. And then we come on through the Old Testament, we show up at Calvary where there's a cross, and the Lamb of God hung on that cross and suffered and bled and died for the sins of mankind. And that blood was shed one more time. That was the last time it ever had to be shed. And off it came, boy, down the sin came. Abel brought a blood offering in Genesis chapter 4. This is Old Testament stuff about the blood. Yeah. Abel brought a blood sacrifice. He brought the animal and laid it down there and brought what God wanted him to bring. And Cain brought a bunch of fruits and vegetables and, here, Lord, take this pineapple for the justification for my sins. And God said, "I don't want that. I told you what I wanted. I wanted that animal over there. I want you to slit his throat, let the blood run out. That's what I wanted." Yeah. And he said, "No, I won't take your offering." And of course, he got mad. Of course, people don't do that today because we're real, we're more mature now. Yes. And when God accepts one man's work and not another man's work, then we don't get jealous and we don't get mad and want to beat his brains in, do we? No, of course not. Abel brought a blood offering. After the flood, Noah gave a sacrifice in Genesis chapter 8. Huh, Bob? I'll just bet you that all them clean animals, I'll just bet you when Noah was gathering them things up, there had to have been some time in his life, said, man, all them 120 years, he must have been saying, what in the world is this, man? Seven of this, three of this, two of this. And he got off of that ark and he took them clean animals and slit their throat and offered them for a burnt sacrifice on the altar that God, that he made for God. Only people alive on the face of the earth. You get over there in the Passover there in the Old Testament, like I just told you about. And Exodus in chapter 12, the Bible said, and the blood shall be for a token under the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. I'm going to pass over you. Not the blood in the veins. You got blood running all through your veins, brethren. And God could have looked at that just as easy as something thrown up there on the door. But I'm telling you that God said, when I see that blood applied to lintels and doorposts of the house, then that's going to make the difference. And that blood made the difference between the people that lived and the people that died. You understand me? That blood that they put on the doorpost over there in the Old Testament, if you didn't have the blood on the doorpost, you died. And brethren, I mean, I'm telling you, it's the same way today. You get over there in the Day of Atonement, then Jews say, well, how did Jews get saved in the Old Testament? Well, that's an interesting question, but one of the ways that, one of the things they had to do out of Leviticus chapter 16 was that they had to make that Day of Atonement. And on the Day of Atonement, that priest took two goats. And he slew the one, and he let the blood go out on the altar. And then he took the other goat, and they laid their hands on the head, and they went in there and confessed all the sins of the nation of Israel on the head of that goat. And then they took him out by a strong man and let him go out there in the wilderness, and he was free man. You know what that's a type of? Amen. All right, good. Then I won't tell you. Two goats. They killed one for a sin offering. They let the other one go. You come over into the New Testament and you find that the blood is being made reference to by every single preacher in the New Testament. There isn't one man that ever got up to preach and didn't mention the blood of Jesus Christ. You come over to the Gospel of John, and you got John the Baptist out there in chapter 1 and verse 36, and John's out there baptizing people and dunking them underneath the water for the remission of sin. And here comes Jesus Christ down there. And John gets over there and points at him. And he says, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. He said about him in verse 36. He said, in whom we have redemption. How? Through his blood. John even knew that, and Jesus Christ hadn't even died yet. The blood of Jesus Christ is the redemption. Paul, over and over and over. Paul in Ephesians chapter 1 and 17. Paul in Colossians chapter 1 and 14. And they mess with those verses and try to take the blood out and try to fool you and mess with you and louse your salvation up. Yeah. Taking the blood out. Right. But without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. I want to say, first of all, the blood is the price of our redemption. We are loosed from sin. We're loosed from sin by the blood of Jesus Christ. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5, the Bible said, unto him that loved us. Thank God that Jesus Christ loves us. Thank God that Jesus Christ loves us. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins, how did he do it? In his own blood. Thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ, and I could care less what every 50 billion Jehovah Witness say. Brother, I know in whom I believe, and I know when that blood got applied, I know what happened down inside of my heart. That the blood will free you from your sins. They had a preacher one time that was preaching, much like I'm preaching this morning, on the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. And it's back a while back, and I had an atheist stand up there, and he said, I got a question for you. How does the blood cleanse sin? Tell me how the blood cleanses sin. Good question. Good question. Of course, it wasn't asked in sincerity. It was asked with a smart aleck, wise guy, wise cracker attitude. And that preacher stopped for a minute and he thought, and he said, How does a glass of water quench your thirst? And the man said, well, I don't know. Our atheist said, I don't know, but it does.
Amen.
I'm telling you something right now. You might not understand it all. You might not know how it does it. But just get it. You're in here and you're lost and you're without Jesus Christ. Just get it. Because the blood of Jesus Christ, you don't have to understand how it works. I come into this room, I'm going to flick on the lights, baby, if it's dark, and I don't know nothing about electricity. When I get over to my house, Dale Kraling has got the plumbing and all that stuff in there. I turn the little spigot on the top, and miracle, water comes out. I'm not going to go to a plumbing school for 4 years, find out how the thing works, before I get a drink. And you don't have to wait to understand how the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from your sin. All you got to do is take him at his word and do it and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I want to say not only is the blood of Christ the price of redemption, but the blood is a promise to you of peace. The blood promises you peace. Peace with God. Peace with yourself. Peace with other believers. Peace with even lost people out here. And my friend, most importantly, peace down inside of that heart of yours. God knows, man, you need peace to live this life today. This is the wackiest, craziest, stupidest state I've ever lived in my life. Everybody driving on your bumper. Everybody mad. Everybody's upset. Everybody just cuss you out at the drop of a hat. They don't love God. They hate God. They hate His commandments. They're not interested in the things of God. And you still got to talk to them. You still got to tell them about the blood. But the blood can be for you and for me a promise of peace. The Bible said in Colossians that Jesus Christ, having made peace through the blood of His cross. You hear me? Through the blood of His cross, that's how it was done. That Bible said over in Romans in chapter 5, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace with God. Brethren, we're sinners. We're dead in trespasses and sins, we were. We were without God. We were without hope. We were strangers from the covenants of Israel. We didn't know nothing about God. Man, and if you'd have picked us up some 800 years ago, you're sitting here all dignified this morning thinking you really something with your job and your brand new car. 800 years ago, you were some stinking heathen over there with an orange thing tied around your loins running around with a bow and arrow. You! Yeah, you! Yeah, you! Well, I now am the president of A&M Amalgamated and all that stuff. Don't give me that gas, man. I'm telling you something. You put you in the right place, boy, you'll rise up with a club and kill people just like Cain did. That's exactly right. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. No man can have peace until he comes to Calvary. You don't come to Calvary, don't kid me. I see them down at my job all day long with their white shirts on and their ties and their Hickey Freeman suits and their floor shine shoes. And boy, they're walking around and, they look at me with Jack here, you know, and my blue collar. And they're going, they walk around and talk to each other so dignified and all that. You're not fooling me. You're not fooling me. I mean, I test them. How's it going, Jack? I said, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanse you from all sin. You know what you do? You kick that veneer a little bit and you chip it and you knock it off. So, well, what's a good word today? He said, repent, you won't die and go to hell. That's a good word. You know what? They see me now. You know what they do? No kidding. They see me now. I'm over there. They're trying to avoid me, brother. I just hope I don't lose my job. Just pray for me. I don't get fired. But I'm sick and tired of the farce and the fake. I have peace because I wear a white shirt and a tie. You're a liar. I wear one every Sunday. And I have to try to get peace inside of my heart. You're not kidding anybody. You can have peace. No man can have peace till he comes to Calvary. At Calvary, we find peace from the past. You come to Calvary and stand there, all of your past sins are forgiven, my friend. You don't have to give account for any of them anymore. All you got to do is get there to Calvary. Just get there, and you can have all your sins cleansed, everything that you've done in the past. There's grace to live this life today at Calvary. There's grace for the present. You hear me? You know the reason you ain't got no grace? Because you don't want any. You want to do what you want to do. The way that you want to do it. And you don't care about this book. You don't care about this Bible. You just want to do what you want to do. So there's no grace available for you until you come back to the cross and sit there and look at Jesus Christ hanging on that cross. Well, your sins are still forgiven from the past if you're saved. But you've got no grace to live this future. All you got is a past that's forgiven, and you're looking for glory in the future. That's what you got at Calvary. Your past, your present, your future, all handled right there at Calvary, brother. And you need to get it. I want to say that we are made nigh through the blood of Jesus Christ. Ephesians and chapter 2 and verse 13, the Bible said, "But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh." Nigh, that means close. That's old English word for means close. You're made nigh by the blood of Christ. By the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And thank God for it. They had a, over in West Africa, early 1900s, they had a epidemic of yellow fever. And the yellow fever came in, and man, it was just dropping. I mean, people just dying. It was a plague, and people just dying by the hundreds of thousands. People just dropping over. And they found one native over there, and they took his blood, and they were using, if you're an animal rights activist, and you know, there's something wrong with you. They were taking blood. Maybe we'll take your babies. Maybe we'll take your children, use them for guinea pigs instead of rabbits and apes and those kind of things. Maybe that'd make you happy. Somebody didn't like it. Well, that's good. I think I just will. I'm telling you something. What would you rather have? Human beings tested? What would you rather have? A bunch of human beings in cages sitting there and inject them? Would that make you happy? I'm going to tell you what the problem with them people is. They'd rather see a human being die than they would an animal. They had them bunch of jackasses out there in Colorado that were injecting chickens in the supermarket with poison and killing people. Because we don't want them eating the poor little animals. Oh, but it's okay to kill a human.
Amen.
And we can get on with this message here.
Amen.
So we are made nigh by the blood of Jesus Christ. There was that epidemic, that terrible thing that killed human beings and those people over there in Africa for just years and years. And they took the blood of one native over there and they injected it into a monkey. The monkey died, and that showed them that that man's blood was, he had built up some kind of an immunity, some sort of antibody to this yellow fever. And they took that man's blood and they manufactured it in 1927. They can reproduce what it is and the chemical breakdown and those kind of things. That vaccine by the Rockefeller Foundation and the government of that nation and other governments, from that original strain, they reproduced that blood and reproduced it and reproduced it through multiplied cultures, and it has offered today immunity to every generation that's come ever since then, since yellow fever has ever been. They just inject them with that man's blood. They reproduce that man's blood, and they continue just these gigantic laboratories with all of these little cultures. I don't know what they do, but they've got that stuff in there. The blood of one man. Hear me. The blood of one man and only one has spared the lives of people in West Africa. And that one man's blood has been made to serve the whole human race and to help people. That's one of the common inoculations that you get, yellow fever. You don't have to worry about it anymore because of one man's blood. Back around 19 and 20 it was. But I want to tell you about another man.
Amen.
Who died on an old rugged cross some 2,000 years ago. And brethren, when his blood was shed,
amen.
When that blood came out, that blood has gone out through all the entire world. That blood has covered every generation of person, of man and woman and boy and girl that has ever been born on the face of this earth. And it has saved countless millions and billions of people that have ever been born on the face of this earth. Thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ. And then finally, I want to say that the blood is power for our service. We want to do something for God. I want to do something for God. And without that blood,
I can't do anything. Without the blood of Jesus Christ, you can't do any service. At Passover, what did the Jews, what did they do? They ate meat. They sat down and they ate meat. They needed strength for service. They were getting ready to go out, and God told them, you sit down and you eat that lamb and you take the blood out of that lamb. You strike it on the doorpost, and I want you to cook that thing, and you invite your family over. And if your family ain't big enough for that thing, invite somebody else over and just have you a good old barbecue that night. While them Jews were over there going, my son, it's got dead. Them Jews sitting in there, they had light and a good day, brother. They sitting in there just rejoicing and having a good time. Them Jews. Hasn't quit working. Boom, 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 boom. It's solid working, man. Pushing that, I don't know what you had for breakfast, I don't know whether you ate grease or what you ate, but whatever it was, that stuff is flowing through your veins, going to the cells in your body, and giving you nutrition because of what you eat. You are what you eat. You know that, don't you? Go ahead and fill up on Twinkies and Hostess Ho-Hos. Go ahead and eat all the Doritos that you want to, and ice cream and hot dogs. And God knows I love everything I just said. God knows I do. But I'm telling you, sometime in your day, you got to eat some veggies in there, and you got to get some lean red meat. You got to get some fruit in there. And I mean, man, God, eat right, man. You are what you eat. You are what you eat. Red cells, this body of ours, brethren, it requires oxygen. Red blood cells carry oxygen to the body cells. And you can't live without air. You can't live without air. If you don't have any air, you're going to drop dead here real soon. Ask Jacques Cousteau. Ask the people who went down in the Titanic. They'll tell you, you got to have air, man. You don't have to believe me. It's all right. You got to have air. And you can't get air. Air circulates through your body through the blood system. You need blood. Got to have it. Well, body requires water. You know how long you live without water? 4 days maximum. Them cells of yours start shriveling up and dying. You got to have, man, you made up of fluids. You got to have everybody taking vitamins. That's another thing. You ain't made up of vitamins. You made up of water and minerals and all that kind of stuff. You say, I want to take a one-a-day thing. Take a mineral. That's what you're made up of, zinc. God made you out of the dust of the ground. He make you out of a bunch of vitamins. I take some A plus here and a little bit of E minor and do all that kind of stuff. You want to eat right? Supplement your diet with that. That water travels in body cells and travels through your blood system, brethren. We drink, and water is absorbed into our blood systems and is carried throughout the blood and delivered to every cell. And that's what keeps you going. That's why you dry up and blow away after you're dead in the casket. There's no water. You ain't had a drink in a long time. Open up the casket, give that man a drink of water every once in a while. I want to say that there are all different kinds of blood types. All different kinds. You got type 1, type 2, 3, 4, all that kind of stuff. But let me tell you something. If I'm a type 1 and I give Paul, who's a type 2, my blood, it don't work. He'll die. He's going to be dead. There is one type of blood. I read this, man. I was really amazed at this. There is one type of blood, like a type 4 blood. And that blood, you can give it to anybody. Anybody can be a donor of that kind of blood. Listen to me. Jesus Christ is a type 4 blood donor. His blood will apply to anybody. That blood, you can take it and give it a transfusion into any sinner that you know. And all it'll do is do him good. You never have to worry about it hurting. There is consecration for service. Over in Leviticus in chapter 8, brethren, if you want to do something for God, the blood of Jesus Christ has got to be applied. Moses took that blood out of the basin, and he applied it to the tip of those men's ears. He applied it over on their hands, and he applied it on sprinkled it on their feet. And they had the blood applied to them, brethren. Well, what is all that kind of stuff? You put it on the ear, and you can't hear the voice of God without the blood applied to the ear.
You got it. That blood means something, brethren. You apply it to your ear, and that way you get to hear what God's got to say to it. You apply the blood to your hands like they did over there in Leviticus. And you can't use your hands. Friend, these things are dead. They're worthless. They're just flesh and blood. Have you ever thought about how much trouble these things have gotten you into? Just your hands. You think about the trouble, right? The trouble that these things have gotten you into. Terrible things. The things that they've touched. You think about where you've put your hands and placed your hands. And brother, it's a terrible thing. You need the blood applied to your hands. You get your hands covered in the blood, brethren, and you know what they do? They hold up a Bible. You get these hands soaked in the blood, and they're good for reading scriptures out of the Bible. They can hold a Bible. They can. The Bible said, lifting up holy hands without wrath. These things are terrible, wicked, ungodly, wicked things, man, unless they're covered in the blood. Put blood on their feet. When you put the blood on the feet, then you're able to walk with God. You can't walk with God the way you are. You got to have the blood applied. Let me say this, that there is power to overcome the devil in the blood of Jesus Christ. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11, the Bible says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. They overcame him. Overcame who? They overcame the devil by the blood of the Lamb. Brethren, you got to have the blood of Jesus Christ applied, or the devil's going to roll over top of you like Rommel going through East Africa. You know that, I don't know if you know it or not, but Napoleon, after his defeat, took a map of the world after he was defeated. Now, that man conquered the entire known world. Napoleon took a map and he pointed to the British Isles. And he said, were it not for that little red spot, I would have conquered the whole world. You know what the devil said? If it wasn't for that little red spot, I could have conquered this whole world. I could have had them all under my power. They'd have all been under my subjection. But that little red spot, thank God for that little red spot. Now, because of that, Satan has to point to the cross and say, I've been overcome by the little red spot. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. I'm done. And I want to say this morning, that just by way of conclusion, with your head bowed there, that there is no substitute for the blood of Jesus Christ, brethren. There just isn't. If you're in here and you don't know Jesus Christ, there's nothing else that'll save your soul from hell. If you're in here and you're saved and you're not living right, you ain't living the way that God wants you to live. I want to tell you something. Only the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse your sins, get you back up on your feet where you need to be. As long as God is holy and man is sinful, there's no substitute for the blood. As long as the devil rules and enslaves men, there'll be a need for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Long as man's conscience is loaded with guilt and sin, there's going to be need for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's power in the blood. We sing that song, there's power in the blood. Do you believe that? You believe there's power in the blood? Have you experienced the cleansing power of the Lord Jesus Christ in your own life? Are you saved? Are you on your way to heaven? If you're a Christian in here, you got problems in your life. You've got things that overcome you and knock you down. The devil, the world, and the flesh gets the victory over you every once in a while. And if it wasn't for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you'd just stay down. But thanks be unto God, brethren, that gives us the victory. That blood can be applied to the doorpost of our heart, and we can have victory. Read a story about an old minister down in Alabama. Been preaching the gospel for 50 years. 50 years, and he was laying on his deathbed. And his son came in, who was also called to preach, came in and knelt down by his father's bedside. And he said, Daddy, he said, you've preached for 50 years. You've done more good than any man that I know. He sat there and cried over his father laying there drifting off into eternity. And the old man with just a feeble voice kind of tried to lift himself up a little bit, and he said, "Son, don't tell me about that. Tell me about the blood of Jesus Christ." That's all a dying man wants to hear, is about the blood of Jesus Christ. And if a man who's been a preacher for 50 years, you know, had a pure, straight life, is dying and wants to hear about the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and friend, how much more do you and I need it to get through this life? It's not enough just to live a clean life. Not enough just to live a straight life and do the best that you can. You need the blood applied to your heart. If you believe that there is power in the blood, tell the world that there's a balm in Gilead that'll heal a sin-sick soul, friend. There's some place for a lost sinner to go and have his sins covered and have himself forgiven and get in right relationship, have the righteousness of Jesus Christ. I want to say this, if you're lost in here, if you ever get to heaven, listen to me, if you're lost, you'll only get to heaven through the blood of Jesus Christ. It's the only way that you can ever have your sins covered. It's the only way that you can ever have your sins washed clean. Would you do that this morning? The song that Diane is playing is God leads us along. And it says that God leads his dear children along. He leads some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fires, but all through the blood. What are you going to do with the blood of Jesus Christ this morning? You're in here, it's been shed for you. You're in here and you're lost. Would you come to Jesus Christ this morning? You're a Christian, things haven't been going your way. You need to come and plead the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and ask him to put you back where you used to be. During the 16th century, there was a terrible revolt that took place over in Holland. And the Dutch people rose up in revolt against their king, against King Philip II. King Philip hired armies. He sent a great army under the Duke of Alva, to suppress the rebellion. And those people held out and fought and did the best that they could do, but the army was just too great for them. And the soldiers coming into the town went from house to house, slaughtered men and women and their children, killed every one of them in their homes, searching for citizens. And there was a group of men and women and children that were hiding in a house. And they heard the soldiers next door slaughtering their neighbors and killing their neighbors' children. And one man had an idea. They took all of the lambs. They raised sheep. And they raised lambs. And they took those lambs and killed about 7 of them right there in the living room floor and let their blood flow out. And that man took the blood and swept it underneath the door. And when those soldiers came to kill them, the one soldier looked down and saw the blood coming out from underneath the door. And he said, "Let's go. The work has already been done here." And those people were saved because of the blood. Christian friend, if you're in here and you know Jesus Christ, you're saved because of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And my friend, if you're in here and you don't know God, you're not saved. Why don't you do that this morning? Why don't you call on Jesus Christ this morning while we sing? What number is that, Diane? 298. 298. God leads us along. Let's stand while we sing. Why don't you come be saved this morning? Don't put it off. Shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet. God leads his dear children along. Cool flow bathes the weary one's feet. God leads his dear children along. Why don't you come right now? Some through the waters, some through the blood. All through the blood. Would you step out right now? Why don't you come to this altar? Say, "Preacher, I want the blood applied this morning. I want to be saved this morning." Sometimes on the mount where the sun shines so bright, God leads his dear children along.
in the valley, darkest of night, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long.
Let me say this to you, that it was a real blessing to me to hear about that young man getting saved right over there in that pew.
Amen.
He didn't even wait for the preaching. I don't know how much preaching he ever sat through. I have no idea. But let me tell you something. If you're lost in here and you don't know Jesus Christ, you just sat through a message that told you that the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, would cleanse you from your sin. You're a Christian in here and you're backslidden. You're away from God. You ain't right with God. I preached a message to you that told you that the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ would take all of your sins and would forgive them and put you back where you need to be as a Christian so that you can go on and serve God. It's off of me, friend. It's off of me. It's on to you. What are you going to do with the blood? Sing on the third. If you need to come, come now on the third.
Though sorrows befall us and Satan oppose, God leads his dear children along. Through grace we can conquer, defeat all our foes. God leads his dear children along. Some through the waters, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long. Away from the mire and away from the clay, God leads his dear children along. Away up in glory, eternity's day, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long.
All right, remember, brethren, that the blood, Christian and unsaved alike, the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, will cleanse you from all sin. Don't let a great deal of time go by without pleading the blood. Don't let a great deal of time go by, Mrs. Christian, Miss Christian, without getting down on your face before God and said, Lord, I did it. I did that, and I did that, and I did that, and the Bible said that it isn't right, and I want you to cover it underneath the blood. You hear me? Do it. Now, Father, I'm thankful for the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I'm glad that there is a fountain flowing, filled with the blood of Jesus Christ, flowing from Emmanuel's vein. Lord, I wouldn't dream of coming home from a hard day of work and not getting cleaned up, not getting showered, taking the soap, washing the filth off of this flesh. And Lord, and I'm praying for these people that there would never be a day that goes by that they wouldn't get down on their face before God and let the filth of that day get washed away in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help them to learn how to plead the blood. Help them to learn how to cover their sins with the blood of Jesus Christ and give them the protection that they need from the devil. God bless them this day. Encourage these people now, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. See you all this evening, 6 o'clock.